Hello, everyone. I will start us off in the interest of time so that we can have more time to hear from our fantastic panelists and speakers today. My name is Regina Mattsson and I represent WFAD, which is a multilateral community of NGOs and individuals working to strengthen prevention, increase access to treatment, and to promote recovery. With 354 member organizations in over 60 countries, we're happy that our members have adopted a 10-year strategic plan to focus particularly on the needs and the rights of women and children within our field. And in doing so, a gender working group was created in 2020 to ensure that we include these imperative aspects in all of our work to build for a more equitable field and offer better services. In honor of International Women's Day and Women's Recovery Month, the WFAD and our gender working group applauds this year's theme as highlighted by the United Nations, which is gender equality today for a sustainable tomorrow, recognizing the contribution of women and girls around the world in building a more sustainable future for all. The goals of Agenda 2030 cannot be realized without recognizing the role that organized crime, trafficking, illicit production, and drug abuse play in undermining sustainable development whilst unequally affecting women and girls across the globe. To ensure a sustainable future without the above mentioned risks, it's vital to recognize and integrate the goals of Agenda 2030, including the Development Goal 3, ensuring healthy lives and promote well-being for all. And with this, placing a particular focus on the Target 3.5 to strengthen prevention and treatment, which for us also includes promoting recovery. So to do our part, we are happy to welcome you today to this webinar to commemorate Women's Day and Women's Recovery Month by inviting prominent speakers to share their personal stories of being champions of recovery and discuss the important areas needed in ensuring gender transformative prevention, treatment, recovery, and reintegration services. So we're very happy to have you all here today, and we hope that you have a wonderful webinar. Without further ado, I will hand over to my colleague, Jochebel Emanuel, who will be our moderator for today's event.
Hello. Thank you, Regina, for the introduction. As she said, my name is Jochebel Emanuel, and I will be the moderator for today's webinar. I would just like to, before going on to the agenda, I just wanted to say happy International Women's Day, and thank you all for joining. We're going to have three women come and speak about their lived experience. And then after that, we're going to move on to our panel with experts who's going to talk about recovery, reintegration, and treatment. So without having too long introduction about me and the agenda, I'm going to move on to our first speaker, who is Cecilia. She's been involved in grassroots activities of recovery organizations in Serbia, Bosnia, and Herzegovina for the last 9 years. Currently, she's working as a consultant in NGO Celebrate Recovery in Sarajevo, Bosnia, and Herzegovina, where she uses her personal lived experience of drug addiction and recovery to help people affected by drug in their recovery journey. She uses art as a therapeutic tool in her work and study pedagogy and art and history at the University of Sarajevo. I will give the floor to you.
Thank you for the kind introduction, Regina and Jochebel. Greetings to all participants. It's a special privilege for me to share with you my recovery journey. I said, entitled my path from expert by experience to expert with experience. I can go to the next slide, please. My organization, Celebrate Recovery, has been established by recovered drug users in 2008. And we work on local grassroots level, providing help and support to individuals and families of drug use. In our work, we promote prevention, treatment, and full recovery from addiction through cooperation with other actors and engaging the resources that already exist in the local community. We are also engaged in advocacy work to influence drug policy on national, UN, and EU levels and members of various networks and umbrella organizations. We established a free and anonymous helpline and the Substance Abuse Community Counseling Center in 2018. We provide individual and family counseling, as well as support groups for people in recovery and their family members. With the pandemic, we started providing online individual counseling and support groups, and we broadened our services to offer also meaningful and educational activities in our daily center. I would like to start with two videos representing my life before and after recovery from addiction. I hope it will work. We could go to the other one. Thank you. As this is my 10th year in recovery, I somehow decided to share these videos, even though it's really emotional for me. I just wanted to give you a presentation of this process that I went through with these actual footages. When we talk about recovery, we often tend to represent it in a black and white from that kind of way. And even though it is to a certain point, it is important to remember that it does not happen overnight. Identity change is a constant fluid process. I have never actually arrived to the finished portrait you see at the end of the video. It is a process that requires effort, perseverance, patience, engagement, as well as support and acceptance from people around you that help you to reinvent yourself through storms of your everyday life. And for me, the language of that constant change is art. And I had the privilege to use it in my counseling work. Let me show you some examples. Go to the next. In the My Life in Recovery photo voicing project, it's on the next slide. We used photography to explore and represent our recovery journeys and to create shared narratives that help us and others to understand this process of change. The online exhibition is still available, and I'm inviting you to have a look. The link will be in the chat. Let me illustrate the insights I got with some photographs and fragments of narratives created through this project. I started working with people with drug-related problems and their families early on in my recovery. I had my story, and I used my lived experience of addiction and recovery to connect and give them hope. I grew with them and through them. The benefit is mutual, but there is an emotional toll, a price to pay. And in order to create health boundaries, I aspire to grow from expert by experience and become an expert with experience. I had the privilege to learn and grow together with experts by training, my dear colleagues, Mediha and Murka. A composition of photographs you see here of colleague Mediha, who is a psychologist, and our shared narrative here illustrates this in a beautiful way. I've used my artwork, we can go to the next slide, please, to address issues that are hard to talk about, such as the inner critic, authority, the inner personal guardian, abuse. We can just go through the slides quickly. So authority, the inner guardian, abuse, the inner struggle. You can see here that it is written psychological and physical abuse across her eyes, and on the other suicide on her head, but warrior and brave on the bat. Then further on, identity, where there is written human across her chest, and you can see on the other, representing toxic relationships, where you can see a realized picture of a wedding with pain written on it. We can go to the next slide, please. Through my work, I have discovered my passion for art therapy and made a 5-year plan for the first time in my life. I have enrolled in the University of Sarajevo, and I'm on the second year of pedagogy and art history. When I finish my basic studies, I can further specialize in art therapy. We can go further to the next slide. But as you can see, there are always bumps on the road. I had an accident last May and spent almost 6 months practically in bed, so I had time to reflect. I have realized the importance of self-care. My perspective changed. I realized that you are not what you do. And I tried to put my priorities in order. And I continued my ongoing effort to live what I preach. We can go to the next slide, please. I would like to conclude with another narrative fragment from the Photo Voice Project. There is no light without a shadow, as a reminder to us all that we should be kind to ourselves and accept all the imperfections that makes us unique, and just keep going. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you so much, Cecilia. Such an inspiring story.
Thank you so much. You are welcome.
I also just wanted to say that you can ask your questions in the chat. We will also have a 15-minute Q&A at the end, so feel free to write your questions down there. Thank you so much again, Cecilia. We will be moving on to Catherine. Catherine is a PLWSUD founder and director of Nakuru Drop-In Center, an interfaith, nonprofit, and outpatient community-based organization dealing with matters and issues connected to drug addiction in Kenya. She helps people to learn and master their mental health care and wellness with an utmost prevention and rich participation to young generation to create, establish, and maintain an ongoing cultivating move in their lives towards becoming better. Through the process of heart-centered transformation, her mission is to help people acknowledge mental health transformation, empowerment, and create stable and healthy lives. I will give the floor to you. Yes. We will move on to the next person. So we have a peer educator from the organization CWEN, Davies Sapkota, is a street connector youth who lives in a rental room with her husband and two children. She was born and brought up on the street, and her parents worked as street vendors to fulfill their basic need. Her mother passed away due to alcohol abuse, and her father is serving a jail term due to his engagement in criminal activities. She married a street connected boy at the age of 16, and she has various history of using various of substance. She became pregnant at 17, and during her pregnancy tested, she came to learn that she had HIV. Her husband also uses substance, and both of them are living with HIV. Since then, they are under our treatment. Davi came in connection with CWIN in 2010, and representatively, she's working with peer educators in the organization, connecting us with other street children. She's been actively engaged in empowering street girls to make them aware of their rights to get into education, report abuse, and seek help needed. So thank you, Davi, for being here. I will give the floor to you.
Yes, Petra. I wanted to thank again the previous stories by Cecilia and Davi. They were very inspiring and very touching. And thank you for inspiring everyone every day in your work and in your daily life. I hope Catherine can join us later with her sound. But for now, I would like to continue to the panelists. First panelist is Petra. Petra Boer has 18 years of recovery experience and is a mentor for women in recovery and working with networking and empowering processes in Wagen Ut. Cooperative and recovery is exciting and life is an adventure. We have three questions, but first I'll introduce all panelists that will be discussed. The next panelist is Julie Schampf, and as a lecturer and researcher at University College Ghent and PhD student at Ghent University, Julie has been working for more than 10 years in the field of healthy lifestyle and addiction. Her research interests focus on qualitative research on substance use, alcohol and drug prevention and treatment, women and trauma. She has a deep commitment to supporting women in their recovery and is a TCTCY facilitator. Our final panelist of today is Chung-Li Kang, also known as Eric, he has worked in the field of addiction under ARTM since 2008 as psychology counselor. And Chung is currently the deputy director of ARTM's Cao Integrative Service Center, formerly the Residential Treatment Center for Male and Female with Addiction Issues. Chung has devoted mostly in offering therapy and rehabilitation services for people who use drugs, alcohol, via psychosocial model and therapeutic community. Chung has presented several researches in a conference focusing on the treatment effectiveness of residential rehabilitation services in Macau. We will go through three questions, and each panel list will have 3 minutes to answer them one by one. I will ask one question, then I'll go through the panelists, we'll ask, and then we go to the second question, and so on. So the first question would be, can you tell us in your experience what works best in this area? So I will start with Petra. Could you please answer the first question?
Yes, hi everyone. Thank you for inviting me to this this great event at this very important day. And thank you, Devi and Cecilia too. It was great listening to you. And I would say, like, I prepared a PowerPoint, but I think I will just talk. And because what's important for us, we work with social enterprises here at Vägen Ut Cooperatives, and we support women in recovery. And for us, what's most important is to work together. We work we have this shame from so you can come from. Go from prison or from the streets. You can come to our women's shelter, and then you can move on to a treatment center, and then to supported housing, and aftercare, and you can get a work training. And then, or education, and finally get employed in one of our social cooperatives. And we have a lot of cooperatives, but I think the most important is I don't know if you heard about Chime, I will share with you just the screen so you will understand what this is that I'm talking about. This is my network is slow here too. It's not good. Well, this is the SHIME framework, and this is something that applies very well to what we do here in the Way Out Cooperatives. We work with this connectedness, and this is what I heard as well is in Cecilia's, in Devi's presentations. Like, these are the parts that are very important in recovery, the connectedness, to have this peer support, understanding, the sharing with each other, not feeling alone, the inclusiveness, and then the hope and the optimism to believe in recovery. Get motivated to change, to have this hope inspiring relationships is so important, and then create this new identity. I could see that too in Cecilia's with the painting of herself that grew through this her like recovery journey there. So and have this meaning, and you both talked about it, this, both Cecilia and Devi, like to find a meaning in life, you know, to be of service, to share, to use your lived experience and share it with others, to help others. And all of these parts like builds up this like empowerment process, and where you can take personal responsibility of your life and control over your life, and like use your strengths. And that's very important. And that's how we work too in Vägen Ut. And we work with this building recovery capital. There's the personal one, the social and the community capital. And we support the women who come to us to build their personal resources, like there's to work on their skills, to find out what values they have, to find out what they want to do in life, to take care of their health and everything like that. But we also work with the social capital to create, to get the women to get involved in networks. Like we can offer treatment, we can offer housing, we can offer work training here, but there's so much more needed and we can't do this alone. So as well as the individual needs to network together with others, we do it as an organization as well. So we use the resources that's around in the community, like 12-step groups. We have a football team here for it's called the homeless football team, where our women can play football together with others. We have groups for mothers with in addiction. We have cooking. Associations where you can like meet up and cook food together, culture, like do pottery or whatever, paint, you know. So, and all these parts are very, very important. So that's how we work very much to like support women to get this broad network of like strong and healthy, like connections in their life. So very important. Thank you
so much. You actually touched also on the second question that we had, which is great, of course. So I'm gonna ask the other panelists to answer the question. Can you tell us in your experience what worked best in your area? And also question number two, positive examples or best practices to share / success story. Julia, I'll hand it to you.
Okay, thank you. I can hear you better now.
That's great.
Yeah. So first of all, thank you for having me. It's really interesting to hear all of you. Thank you also, Cecilia and Devi for your testimony, I hope. Catherine will be able to join us, then we can hear her. Basma, I think you touched on some really, really interesting findings, and I recognize so many things of this SHINE model of yours. Overcoming stigma is very, very present in our research as well. Peer support, dreams and aspirations, also very important. I think that everyone in practice and research is very clear on the fact that women are a very heterogeneous group. Therefore, it's extremely difficult, I think, to identify what works best because one woman is not the same as another woman, of course. But one thing that I would like to touch ground on is an integrated approach. I think what you said, Petra, is so very important. I actually finished writing an article at 2 a.m. this morning, actually, on an integrated approach for women. So not only drug addiction care, but also mental health care, child care. And exactly what you were saying, I think that's very interesting. Football hobbies, groups, and football and pottery and cooking. I think that's very interesting. Good practice that I can take with me to our services here in Belgium. So the integrative approach is very important. Building a network, building a supportive sort of kind of structure around women is very important. Another thing that I think is interesting in our research is the need for a combination of mixed gender and single gender initiatives in treatment for women. Of course, safeguarding the feeling of safety for women at any point, but I think it's important that women learn to interact in a healthy way with men and vice versa as well, that men learn how to interact in a respectful way with women. I think that's very important in, and it leans towards the gender transformative perspective of Peterson and Lorraine Greaves. I don't know, maybe some of you have heard about them. They plead to address the causes of gender-based health inequalities, and they work to transform harmful roles and genders and norms leading to gender equity. So that's an important thing. So next to empowering women in a strengths-based, trauma-informed way, it's important to look broader and to look at the gender norms that are living in our society. And then, of course, another thing that I'm really in favor of, it's next to very, very next to my heart, a holistic approach in treatment for women. I think it's very important, touching body, mind, as well as spiritual. I think that also kind of leans towards the dreams and aspirations, finding meaning in life next to the body and the mind is very important. So I think that's for the what works best in this area. Do you want me to elaborate on the positive examples or?
Absolutely, you can go ahead.
Yeah, okay. So as an adjunctive therapy, yoga is commonly integrated into addiction treatment. However, conventional yoga practice does not intentionally address the underlying trauma that many with addictive use disorders have experienced. And PTSD is very common and a chronic disease among women at a much higher rate even than men. So recent studies confirm that the majority of substance abusing women often have experienced sexual and or physical abuse. So women with complex trauma histories often feel disconnected from their bodies and struggle to feel safe in their own skin. So considering the growing body of evidence highlighting the significant role trauma plays in the development and exacerbation of substance use disorders, it's imperative that treatment approaches address trauma and addiction systems simultaneously. So that in combination with our previous research that showed that women prefer a holistic approach of their recovery and treatment, we're now exploring the interplay of trauma and addictive use disorders among female substance users. So we defined trauma-centered, trauma-sensitive yoga, TCTSY. It's an evidence-based adjunctive treatment for complex developmental trauma or chronic treatment-resistant PTSD. So it was developed in Brooklyn, Massachusetts, and it's currently a program at the Trauma Center and Embodiment over there. So it's an empirically validated clinical intervention for complex trauma or chronic treatment-resistant PTSD, and it's included in and published by SAMHSA. So the foundations of TCTSY are trauma theory, attachment theory, and neuroscience, and of course, Hatha yoga, with an emphasis on body-based yoga forms and breathing practices. So currently we're implementing TCTSY in an outpatient and a residential service for addiction treatment, and we want to map how women experience it. So the preliminary results are very promising. Women report perceived benefits, such as feeling of calmness, of rest, of peace while and after doing a TCTSY class. They describe it as a moment to not think of any of their problems, but only being present in the moment with their body. And they see it as an opportunity of choice that's very important, and the possibility to modify movements and shapes as they wish. They feel that that's very empowering in their being and their body. So that's a very interesting approach, and I'm really looking forward to further disseminating TCTSY here in Belgium. Thank you.
Thank you, Julie, so much for your answers. We are going to go ahead and ask Chung if you would like to answer the two questions. Do you want me to say those again?
It's okay. It will be the first two questions, right? Good. It's evening here in Macau. Good evening, everyone. The The TC, the therapeutic community model that we adapt in LTM, is pretty much similar to what Petra is suggesting in the chime, that we focus on the personal growth of the person. And I think that the best experience we have is to have treated everyone as himself or herself or oneself as a unique person with different kinds of needs, also with addiction in most of the time in our treatment surface. It's very, very important to recognize the needs of different people. Like, for example, when we first launched our treatment center for females, adults in Macau, at that time, we don't have any kind of residential service for female adults. But the first case that came to us, she's with a baby, and that is a child. It already brought up a new challenge to us, that a mother with an infant is seeking for residential treatment service. At the time, we are not really familiar with that area, but to support the person, we try to develop the service according to the needs of this person. And we help her, we supported her in rearing the infant. She brought the baby also together with her to stay in our residential service. That, and eventually she maintained the maternal relationship with the child, and also to start another family with another person in later future. That brought the really precious experience, that the needs of the people to be addressed during the treatment of the residential service is very important, to recognize them as a unique person. And then in recent years in Macau, because there's a shift from using heroin to methamphetamine and alcohol, and it brought up another issues of women and also men coming to our residential service for rehabilitation with mental disorder issues. So that also brought challenges to us, and the cooperation between different sectors with the medical support, with the psychiatric hospitals, specialized trainings for counselors, social workers in the facilities, and also peer counselors in the facilities, helped to maintain the rehabilitation that we are offering to the people, and to address these different needs. We even have people with dementia or sometimes even delirium, developmental cognitive issues. In our setting, that the different needs of these people should be addressed by us, the service providers, by our professionals, by a place, a setting that's offering security, rehabilitation, and support to them. And I think that we should never stop, like LTM, always evolving our therapeutic models, our treatment effectiveness, the supports that we can get from this community. We try to bridge up the career development of the people, of the residents in our service. That's also the reason why we changed into an integrative service center in the year 2022, to cooperate more with the community, to build up the connectedness between the people within the therapeutic community, and also outside with the community, with different sectors. So eventually the holistic development of the person, no matter is to be employed, to build family, to get community resources, or their family relationships, are all taken care within the rehabilitation process. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you for your answer. We will move into the last question. But before I do that, I just wanted to say that if you have any questions or something that you would like to ask, you can put it in the chat. We will have a 15-minute Q&A, but please still put it in the chat before that as well. So we'll move on to the last question.
Short.
I will say that again.
I seem to be some type of.
You can't hear me?
You can't hear me?
Sound is cracking up again.
Sorry about that. It seems like we're all struggling a little bit with the sound. So I'll just take over and ask the last question to all of our panelists. And that is, what would you recommend in moving forward? So I'll hand over to Petra first and then Julie and Eric. And I see we have some questions in the Q&A for after. And if you, any of you participants or other panelists would like to ask any questions, you're welcome to write those in the chat or in the Q&A. But I'll hand over to you, Petra, now.
Thank you. Yeah, thank you, Eric. It was interesting also about this. It's similar with us. We have to be like flexible and adapt to the needs. And that's, I was thinking of, that's how our women's shelters started, because there were no shelters for women in addiction here in Gothenburg. So if you were a victim of violence and in addiction, you weren't allowed to get a shelter. So you had to be like clean or sober to get help. So that's why we started our women's shelter. And we welcome women who's also like on drugs. So that's important, to be flexible. And I would also say that for like a way further, to what's important is to build this recovery capital, and the city and the local authorities need to help out with that, to support the organizations that work with and for recovery, to create the possibilities and the arenas to meet. Here in Gothenburg, we have what we call a recovery network. It's a network of organizations who work with recovery, and we meet maybe 4 or 5 times a year, and we do things together, and we try to like be a arena for recovery here in the city, and connect people and make it possible for people who wants to find recovery to see what there is to choose among, you know. So that's what's important. Housing is important too, like to get landlords to cooperate, to provide housing, and so to get people off the streets. So, but cooperation, like for us, we run our enterprises as cooperatives, and cooperation and collaboration is super important for us. So we can't do it alone. We have to do it together. So thank you.
Thank you, Petra. Very, very valuable to keep that in mind, that we can't do it alone. We have to do it together. And that goes for all of us, no matter, you know, within which area of the field that we're working, it's important that we join hands. And especially in terms of offering services that are accessible to everyone, no matter their gender or where in the world they are or in which situation they are residing. So thank you for that, Petra. Julie, how would you like to answer this last question?
First of all, I would like to agree to Petra and say that she touched a very interesting point. We do have to do it together, definitely. I think also important is part of what Eric also said, we have to meet women and men where they are. We have to not only let them come to us, where they are, what they need in their particular stage of life. I think it's important to keep on making the alcohol and drug addiction care that's being developed through the lens of men, of course, more sensitive to the needs of women, but as long as we don't change harmful gender norms in society, I feel like we're mopping with the tap running. So We have to think about ways to change these gender norms among policymakers, service providers, service users, but of all that, among boys and men and among girls and women. So in that regard, it might be an interesting perspective to involve men and explore how that can affect health outcomes for both men and women. Also, I think the holistic approach is very important in treatment and recovery, so body, mind, and spiritual in a spiritual way. And I think more and more attention should be paid to trauma-informed working and atmosphere of trauma-informed. So I think that's important too. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Julie, and definitely trauma-informed services are very much important for this, and also what you're saying about including men in this as well. I mean, gender equality is something that is fruitful for everyone, no matter if you're a woman or a man or a young girl or young boy. It's something that we can all benefit from. So thank you for that. Eric, would you like to answer the question as well?
Yeah, sure. I would line up with Julie about the mix of men and female, because in our integrated service centers, they are living together, although not in the same room, but they are in the same areas, especially during the free period activities and also in the vocational trainings, that we mix the people together. And it sort out to be an interesting thing, study to see how that will affect that the interactions between the people, and see how they developed the interpersonal relationship with another gender. I think that we should never stop with our development in the professional standards, in our trainings, in our knowledge, and also policymaking, and also the supports to the people. Like what Julie said, the trauma is extremely common among people with addiction, especially among females. A sexual one, physical one, that's very common that we can see. And the comorbidity of mental disorders is observed to have the same occurrence among female who use drugs or use alcohol. And eventually we will need to equip with ourselves a lot of expertise or professional knowledge, like with mental disorders, medical diseases, policy making, and public health issues. All these are necessary to take care of the lives of the people who are counting on us to support them, like Petra setting up the shelter for females who before they had nowhere to go. We LTM also set up the residential service for the females, where, and it's still the same somehow in some of the other social institutions, that they refuse people with addiction issues to enroll into, like elderly houses, like shelters for homeless people. And I think the importance of joining the sectors in the societies is always important, that people acknowledge the work on addictions, people understanding what is addiction, that is the public health issues, and the person that they are facing is a human being instead of a drug user or addict, as they called in the ancient times. That is the community promotion and connections with companies, with enterprises for career development, or for proper advocacies will be extremely crucial, and support the people to reintegrate into the society that everybody is living with. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Eric, for these wise words. And I'll keep you on because we have a question for you in the chat. We have three questions. So one is directed towards you, and then I'll open the floor for our other speakers, as well as Cecilia and Devi, if you'd like to contribute as well. You're most welcome to do so. The question to you, Eric, is from Gladys, and she asks, which could be considered to be approach for the interest of children? So the right approach, I assume, for the interest of children. Taking the children off of female drug use for treatment, or allowing them to be with the children for effective child prevention?
Oh, it's a very difficult question instead, but yet interesting to think about it. Normally, we remain the decision to the person. She is the mother. She is the one who gives birth to the baby. Or if it's a man, he's the father who is taking care of the. He's the person is the caretaker of the child, and the decision. Literally by the law itself is the person is the only one who can make the decision for himself and or herself. But eventually we also have occasions that you may encounter the prosperity of the baby is impaired, and you may consider the child to be separated from the caretakers in that sense. But from research, I think you can see that early separations and of a mother child or father child will be the detachment between the caretakers and children will be extremely risky. I would say it may not be 100% harmful, but it will be risky for the development, both for the children and also for the caretakers in that sense. So it will be very very. Difficult to make a sharp cut in the decision making, but you need to face the persons and to see what kind of resources, what kind of risks the person may have to take if he or she is going to take the baby with them, or whether the baby is has to be taken away from the person, and the follow-ups on the decisions need to be addressed. It's very important of that.
Thank you, Eric, and I'm sure. You know, it's good, like you say, as well, to make individual decisions when it comes to this aspect. And also, I mean, just to highlight the fact that this is one of the many problems or difficulties in terms of barriers that women face in accessing treatment is just the issue of, you know, perhaps there isn't an accessible daycare or another person in the family who can take care of the child or the baby during that time of treatment. So it's one of these issues that it's important for all of us to continue to discuss and, you know, try to find evidence-based practices and best practices. So thank you, Eric.
Yes, I think one of the responsibilities as service providers, we are to ensure that when they choose the interventions or when they choose to be helped, we are there to support them. That's very important of our responsibilities to provide the chances for these people, no matter whether they choose to live with their children, or whether they have to be separated, or whether they remain in the community, that we are obligated to provide the support to them, no matter which decision they are choosing.
Thank you for that. We have another question in the Q&A from Gladys, which revolves around CHIME. She asks if CHIME can be achieved where stigmatization of drug use and gender-based violence is highly obtainable. I don't know if Petra, Julie, Eric, or any of our other panelists here would like to answer that. You can just take the floor. Perhaps Julie, you'd like to say something, or Petra, I see you're unmuting.
I was just, could you repeat the question, please?
Yes, sorry. So Gladys writes that she appreciates the program CHIME and asks if it can be achieved where stigmatization of drug use is high and where there is gender-based violence. So within the realm of gender-based violence, I assume, if CHIME is possible.
I don't know, but I would say that CHIME is like I would say it's possible, you know, to because if you look at like 12-step movements that have like meetings all over the world in all in different countries and it's like a lot of the parts from CHIME could be like applied to the 12-step approach to recovery. So I think that would work. Like, I agree with Julie. It's like this holistic view, it's or approach, it's very important, because it's not like, it's not only about the drugs, it's much more than that. So, and it's But I think, yeah, absolutely, that it could be. But it's if it's a lot of like gender, or what did you call it? Like violence, men, violence. It's for women, it's important to get shelter or to get like space to be able to and connected to other women, you know, to get like a place where you can like find a recovery in the, without being like scared or a victim of what violence. So, but you can find that, I'm sure you can find that in like women's 12-step groups or association for women, or I'd say.
Thank you, Petra.
Thank you.
We have a comment here in the chat as well from Monica Barsanti from San Patriano. She says that CHIME is actually the tool to overcome stigma, empower people and women in particular, and to fight gender-based violence. And it's what you're saying as well, Petra, you know, CHIME is a model also for the community approach to reduce stigma in the communities, to ensure recovery-oriented systems of care, to, you know, highlight that recovery is possible whilst providing, like Eric, Julianne, Petra have said, this holistic approach in ensuring the well-being of the whole person. And if there's gender-based violence or intimate partner violence involved, I mean, that is where I'm sure, you know, trauma-informed treatment and support is very much important as well to ensure that a person, you know, to support a person on their recovery journey.
Yeah.
Thank you. I don't know, do a little wave if you'd like to answer say something more. Otherwise, we have a third question here in the chat as well. And I think here it would be great to hear from any of you who've had this experience. It's from Asia Ashraf from Pakistan. She says, hats off to all of you. Keep it up. And she asks, cultural aspects play an important role in strengthening recovery. Please tell us more about how your culture supported or hindered your recovery. So perhaps this is whoever would like to take the lead on this, if your culture was supportive of or hindering in your recovery journey or in the work that you do in terms of treatment and recovery. See, Cecilia is unmuted, so I'll give you the floor.
I think that culture plays an extremely important role. And I remember early on in my recovery, it was in Serbia, actually, in Novi Sad. And I was like paralyzed by a feeling of shame. And I just wanted to, I don't know, climb under a rock and stay there, recovered. But I was kind of pushed into the spotlight and the media. And actually, I was surprised. I was surprised how well the public responded and how much support I got. I was all about like, what are people going to say about me, about my family? It's like, it's not a big city and people know each other. And actually I was really horrified. And then I was surprised. So I think that we should make an initiative and try to do our part and and kind of influence the culture that we live in. And I know that, you know, it's not like a sure thing that you will get a positive feedback, but there are, I think that art, for example, is a great tool to achieve this. And using photo voicing, making exhibitions, doing something, organizing events, and just reaching out to the public with something that can help them to understand what we went through and what we are struggling with. So that's it in a nutshell from me.
Thank you, Cecilia. Thank you so much. Does any of our other speakers, or would any of you like to share on this in terms of culture? I mean, For instance, Julie, you spoke about gender transformative approaches and the fact that we need to work on gendered norms. I guess that could be one such culture that could hinder people, and where we see a lot of this double stigmatization against women who use drugs and women in recovery, where there are these normative ideas and ideals of how to be and how to act. I saw you unmuted, so I'll give the floor to you, Julie.
Yeah, I agree. And I can maybe come to the comment of Monica in the chats. Sometimes self-stigma is even more difficult to overcome, more paralyzing than external stigma. Yeah, and I think both social stigma and self-stigma are very, very much related. And self-stigma is often an internalization of social stigma. So I think if we want to change something in the core, I think society at large is where we should knock on the door and say, yeah, and try to change, think of initiatives and programs to change the gender norms, or to try to accomplish a shift in gender norms. Yeah.
Thank you, Julie. We have another question here as well from Gladness, who says that I really like the approach of focus on the strengths of your clients and targeting people rather than their weaknesses. What if their strength is to just be given things like food or clothes, while you know that if you train them on bread making, bakery, so that they can eat and also sell some of this to get funds for other things? And she's saying, I'm thinking in an African way of saving people. And I think, Gladness, you're highlighting something really important here, that a lot of the work that civil society does, and especially among WFAD members in African countries, it's a lot of this work in vocational training and strengthening people and ensuring this cooperative approach that I know that Petra works with as well. And I'll let everyone answer, but I see that Catherine is back. So I just wanted to check, Catherine, if you're able to unmute yourself, perhaps you would be able to share your experiences from Kenya and your work that you're doing. Let's see if we can hear you. We can see you, oh, but we don't hear you, unfortunately. We can see you, but not hear you. Perhaps, Catherine, if you would like to write in the chat box, I can read out loud for you. There is some difficulties today with the audio. I'm very sorry about this. It would be great to hear your contribution. Well, Catherine is working on that. Is there anyone else who would like to share on this approach, the strength-based approach? Perhaps, Petra, a bit of what you do at Wagen Ut in terms of social enterprises would be a good example.
Sorry, Regina, I didn't really get that. What did you want me to share on?
The question is regarding the strength-based approach, and if it's possible to work with people who are living in poverty, I guess, who need things like food and clothes and making a living, if there are any ways of doing that, you know, and strengthening people's possibilities in maybe learning how to bake and sell that bakery. And
Yeah, all our enterprises, we have 14 enterprises, and all of them are cooperatives. So we run them together. It's and 98% of all our employees, 150 employees, have this lived experience, comes from some sort of like social exclusion, addiction, or being in prison, or mental illness, or like that. So, and they come to us and work. If you work here, you work 100% of your ability, which can be 2 hours a day for someone and six or 8 hours a day for someone else. And it's and you learn skills here. You learn, like, you don't have to have any skills, like a lot of people haven't gone to school or have been living, like been homeless. So you learn here. We have like educations, internal educations, and we send people to get educated outside, or we get people here to educate us. So you can work with in the kitchen with food, or you can work with screen printing, or in the carpentry, or in the gardens, or with farming or whatever. So there's a lot of different pet dog care, like pet sitting, dog sitting. And so there's a lot of, you can like learn a profession here with us and be like self-supported. So it's for us, it's working. I think it's a great way of strengthening people and empowerment and feeling part of and all those parts, very important.
Thank you, Petra. And if our participants here are doing any work that is related to this, you're most welcome to share it in the chat as well, and we will read it. It's always great to hear about your great work as well. Unfortunately, we can't really get the sound to work for Catherine. So we will ask Catherine to record her presentation later on, and we will share it with everyone so that we can all take a bit of experience also from Catherine's work in Kenya and Nakuru Dropping Center. I know that Catherine was speaking about a professional outpatient approach, having comprehensive and intensive guidance and support, and lifelong treatment plans and aftercare and the importance thereof. So hopefully we can share her video and her story with you later on. If there is any other comments from our great speakers, you're most welcome to provide them now, or any chat, any questions from our participants. And if not, I will hand over to Mocha to finish us off. And yes, we will certainly share Catherine's experience, and that through networking, collaboration, research, and advocacy, WFAD will be able to get to an effective evidence-based approach to the female drug user and the issue on child protection during treatment. Thank you, Gladys, for that comment. We hope so as well. But thank you so much, and for being here with us despite of the challenges that we have had in the sound and the video. But I'd like to hand over now to Mocha, our dear colleague, to conclude.
Thank you, Regina. And also I want to continue on the chime, and that also answers a little bit the last two questions, because the basic idea of the chime is to assess the programs and see if they were effective in supporting recovery journeys. And are those enabling and supporting all five of these components? And in the translation of this in our own work in the addiction area, we see that there is a clear sequence to how this works. So for example, human connections, and in particularly of those in recovery, generates the sense of hope that Cecilia and everyone was talking about. And it kind of brings the hope that the change is possible. And this hope fuels and drives a generative virtuous cycle of meaningful activities. And that's also what you're doing in Africa, like building meaningful activities for people to feel important and to build positive identities and grow the sense of empowerment and how it manifests in self-esteem and self-efficacy. And the implication of this model is that this is a starting point of recovery support services, and that it builds connections to pro-social groups and the individuals in particular, and also those who are already in stable recovery. So this can be used by people in early recovery or by those who are still struggling with addiction as a way to generate the hope and empowerment and self-esteem. Mm-hmm. And I want to thank you, everybody, so much for being part of this very inspiring event. And I just want to highlight that women and girls as champions of recovery and prevention and treatment do function as a change makers for inclusion and for development. Your participation and our participation and leadership are needed when ensuring the equal access to treatment, to trauma-informed services. And also, we need to recognize that addiction and substance use is a healthcare problem, and also address housing, employment, educational needs, and all of those things that you mentioned during this event, but taking really good care of gender equality and gender-sensitive approach. So I think it's really a time for us to acknowledge the and society to acknowledge the importance of and role of supportive communities and recovery champions in providing recovery-oriented systems of care. And although there are many paths to recovery, as we see, the common goal remains, and it's that recovery doesn't happen on a clinic, it happens in the society, and no one recovers alone, and we cannot do it alone. Lived experience and also best practices are critical in recovery and reintegration of women in recovery. And so I want to congratulate and thank all these strong ladies who use their stories to help others and to spread hope and belief that recovery really is possible, regardless of the price they pay every time they use their personal stories. And I'm so happy we have experts and researchers with us today, and together we can promote CHIME and also build on synergy between experts by training and experts by experience, and aim to enable services to best meet the needs of women and support them to live meaningful lives. And these stories are breaking the stigma and breaking and barriers to recovery and what's happening in a treatment and addiction services. And we as a WFAD gender working group stand in support for such inspiring efforts in achieving inclusive and equal society for all women and girls out there, while also focusing on gender specific needs. So please also visit our website and read the articles and watch the video series that many of our members contributed to International Women's Day. And thank you, Regina, and everybody who participated today, Cressida and Jochebel, and hope you have a very happy International Women's Day.